Greetings again today in that name that's far above every name, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good to see you here today in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church. We know it's a little stormy on the outside, but we appreciate you that's coming on in for the service here this morning. We have some visitors, glad to have you. And we appreciate you out in the radio listening audience tuning in the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping this hour coming up will be an inspiration to everyone. Linda, our daughter-in-law, heart's broken this morning. She just followed her grandfather to the grave this past week and passed on. That's what she's weeping about, I'm sure. You know, we've traveled many miles. But there's a time coming we're going to travel that last mile. We don't know when that's going to be, and it pays to be ready. Now the singing and the message, the music and all will be on tape number 358. I'm speaking today on the subject, Simon Peter's Blunders. And you can write in to get the tape by request, it'll be $3 each. I have a list of some 350 tapes of Sunday morning programs. They're $3 each. You write in, request them. You can call them by number or by title. And just write in and say, Preacher Edward, send me tape number 358. That's today's tape. And I appreciate our listeners out in the radio listening audience. 50 years ago yesterday, I came over for Thanksgiving from South Carolina. On Thursday, I was employed over in Greenville. I'm a native Georgian, but I spent some time in Greenville, born and reared out here in Madison County, and we spent about 8 years, my wife and I, over in Greenville. Our children are all born over there, but anyway, I was employed at that time, but I'd been courting a little black-eyed, black-headed girl over in Georgia for some 3 years. We began our courtship at the age of 16, and then at the age of 19, I came over and picked her up, and we crossed the river and was married just over in South Carolina. The man asked her, said, wilt thou? And she wilted, and she's been wilting ever since. I've been 50 years of wilting, but she's been a very gracious, wonderful helpmate, and I thank God for her. But our children is going to, they planned their 50th wedding anniversary, our golden wedding anniversary. This afternoon, a reception out here in the Fellowship Hall, and this came kind of surprise to me. I told them I'd rather they wouldn't bother about things like that. My oldest daughter, Joan, said, I don't care what Daddy says, we're going to do it anyway. Well, all three of them's been like that ever since they've been in the world. I didn't care what Daddy said, they did it anyway. But anyhow, they planned it and put forth a lot of effort. And it's going to be nice, and my wife and I don't deserve it. We appreciate it. My wife may, but I don't deserve it. But I appreciate it so very much, the effort they've put forth, and along with their companions, in providing for the reception to be at 3 o'clock this afternoon out here in the Fellowship Hall, just directly joining the church at Northside. And I know the weather's bad, but still I feel there'd be quite a few that put forth that special effort to come and show their appreciation. And I have many friends out in the radio listening audience I've never really met that's been listening to us over the years. My wife is our secretary in our radio ministry, and she's done a tremendous job over the years. And we'd like to shake the hands of many of our dear friends from the radio listening audience, if you can manage to come in for the reception at 3 o'clock this afternoon here at Northside, just to see you and shake your hand. And many of you we've known over the years and pastored over the years and been with you in meetings and fellowship over the years. If you can manage to drive in for a few minutes and let us shake your hand and see you again this afternoon at 3, we most certainly appreciate it. Nobody's excluded. Every member of this church is invited. I know that children sent out a few cards to a few of our relatives and so forth, but everybody's invited that wants to come. I want you to know that. And we'd certainly be glad to have you to come right in for the reception at 3 o'clock this afternoon. Maybe the weather will kind of lighten up and it'll be better. I hope so. And so we appreciate it. I appreciate my precious children going to the trouble to do this. And may God bless them and anyone else that's had a part in this special occasion. Now I have a book here on Bible questions and answers. I have 5 of these books, 150 Bible questions and answers everyone should know. And you write in and get this book. If you send in a gift of a couple of dollars, help pay for printing and stamps and so forth, have a little left, help pay for radio time. And on page 2 of book number 3, you'll find the answers to these questions. Where in the Bible does it say God shook people up with thunder? Where in the Bible does it say God will smite his hands together? Who in the Bible cursed the day he was born? Who was struck dumb by an angel because of his unbelief? What man had 2 angels to visit him and had trouble persuading them to stay in his backslidden home because they preferred to abide in the street? What are the 7 colors in the rainbow and their meaning? What was the 2nd question God ever asked man? What woman was so weak that God let the dogs eat her body lest people go to her grave and say, this is her? Where does it say in the Bible that 70 sons of a king had their heads cut off and put in a basket? What king's 2 sons smote him while he was worshiping a false god? What great king began to reign at the age of 8 years old? What men in the Bible had faces like lions? What woman despised her husband when she saw him dance before the Lord? Where do we find the first recording of men living in houses, the first record rather? Where do we find the first plaster used in a house? Where do we find 3-story houses mentioned in the Bible? And where does the scripture speak of house paint? Now that's on page 2. You'll find those answers of book number 3. If you'd like to have all 5 of our books, just write in, say, Preach Edwards, send all 5, send in a gift of $10 or more, request the books, we get them right in the mail to you. And if you'd like to have a list of our cassette tape, we'll send you a list of 350. And if you'd like to have a brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour, then write for the brochure. We're planning tour number 15 in March of next year, a real tour of a lifetime. And there may be some of you today, you usually go to your church maybe on Sunday, but you didn't go today. Let me ask you a question. Have your pastor ever been to the Holy Land? You may say, Preach Edwards, he hasn't. One of the greatest things you could do for him is get the people in your church together or get a group together and send your pastor to the Holy Land. I'll tell you, it'd be invaluable, equivalent to many years in the seminary, and he'll always appreciate it. And maybe if you want to send some of your young people or go yourself, we've had young people really hearts touched over there on these tours. And write in to get this brochure or call me or come by and see me. I'll supply you with the brochure. It gives you the price, where we'll be going, how long we'll be gone. And the tour is in March of next year, the 7th of March. But now is the time to get your name on the list. You pay a small down payment. The balance will be due after the first of the year. So you write in and get the brochure for the Holy Land tour. Don't fool around and miss out. I've had people say, Preach Edwards, before you discontinue these tours, I want to go. Well, I don't know. This may be my last one. I don't know. I don't know that I'll be going again after this year. May or may not. And if you want to go with me, I advise you to go now. And so you plan for it. Talk to me about it. It's very reasonably priced. One of the best prices we ever had. Turn to Mark chapter 14. I've had people ask me about the Scofield Reference Bible, the original Scofield Reference Bible. I have about a dozen Bibles in my study. The original Scofield Reference Bible. I bought these Bibles so I could let people have them for at least a $10 discount from the retail price. If you're interested, you might want to get one of these Bibles if you're thinking about a gift like that for Christmas time or any other special occasion. Turn to Mark chapter 14, will you please? And I'm going to begin reading with verse 27. It's on page 1065. Page 1065, Mark chapter 14. Let's begin with verse 26. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. And Jesus saith unto them, And ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. But Peter said unto him, Although all shall be offended, yet will not I. And Jesus saith unto him, Verily I say unto thee, that this day, even in this night, before the cock crows twice thou shalt deny me thrice. But he spake the more vehemently, If I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise said all the others. Now that's reading from Mark chapter 14, verses 26 through 31. And speaking on the subject, Simon Peter's blunders. I failed to give you my mailing address. I told you how to get these things and failed to give you the mailing address. If you don't know it already, my mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603. This is a faith ministry. You can have a part in it. Right, Tim, and I appreciate it very much. Now, bringing this message pertaining to Simon Peter and some terrible blunders that he made, I want you to listen to it, lest you make the same blunders. Now, a lot of people said Simon Peter was the first pope. That's a lie of the devil. Simon Peter was never a pope. Simon Peter was never in Rome. In secular history or the Bible tells you, I never mentioned Simon Peter ever being in Rome, Italy. He was never a pope. In fact, popery did not begin until several hundred years after Simon Peter was dead. And so Simon Peter was only an apostle, a little stone like the other apostles. But there's several things he did that'll help us if we'll take note to it and abide accordingly. But I want you to notice that, as a way of introduction, that Simon Peter is related to the number three in many different ways. If you want to jot these down, it might help you. You might make a study of it. He was one of the three in the inner circle. There was an inner circle that ministered with Jesus, and he was one in that inner circle, Peter, James, and John. Number two, he was a third person to join Christ. Number three, three times he was commanded to watch and pray. Number four, three times he went to sleep. Number five, three times he denied the Lord. Number six, three times the Lord asked, Lovest thou me? Three times he confessed the Lord. Three times the Lord asked Peter to feed his sheep. Three times a vision appeared to him on the housetop. Three times the voice said, Rise, Peter, kill and eat. Three times he said, Not so, Lord. Three men came and called for him. The third day he went with the three and six, two threes. And Peter was three times in prison. Three times he escaped out of prison. And when he preached on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 were saved. Now you have Simon Peter in 16 different ways connected with the number three. That might mean something to you in reading about this great man, the great apostle. But there's several things about him I want to call your attention to. And I want you to notice he was boasting in himself when he should have been trusting in the Lord. It's a dangerous thing to brag in yourself within your own strength and power and wisdom when you know you need to trust God. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 35, Peter said unto him, Though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. Here he was bragging about what he would do, and he told Jesus, I won't deny you, I will even die for you. He was trusting in his own strength and power. Now, as a child of God, you need to realize that you must trust in the Lord. He that's in you is greater than he that's in the world, and through his anointing and help strength and strength, you can serve God. You can't do it within your own strength and power. You must rely on him. We find, secondly, he was asleep when he should have been wide awake. In Luke chapter 26 and verse 40, the Bible said, He that is Jesus came unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What, could you not watch with me 1 hour? At the very time that Simon and Peter should have been watching and wide awake, he was sound asleep. Simon and Peter went to sleep on the job. I'm afraid today we have too many that are saved and yet they're asleep on the job. Not wide awake, not on the alert as they should be. We find again that he was fighting when he should have been following. Simon Peter wanted to fight. He is high-tempered. He is impulsive. And he wanted to fight whenever the occasion arose for him to do so. He was that kind of fella. He'd fight it to drop your head, and then he would drop his hat many times in a chance to get a chance to fight. But anyway, we find he was fighting when he should have been following the Lord. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 51, And behold, one of them which was with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck a servant of the high priest and smote off his ear. Now the Bible lets us know who that person was. It was none other than Simon Peter. When Judas Iscariot brought that mob in to take Jesus in for trial and crucifixion, Simon Peter didn't like it. He grabbed his sword and he met him out there, and we find that the high priest was standing nearby, and Simon Peter just took his sword and he meant to have cut his head off. He wasn't striking at his ear. He was striking at his head. He wanted to take that sharp sword and remove that man's head from his shoulders, because he had come to take Jesus and carry him into trial and to crucify him, and Simon didn't like that, and he wanted to get in a fight about the thing, and he hit that man with that sword, and God caused the man to move his head. Now Simon Peter wasn't that bad of a person in the way of aiming at what he was hitting at. He could usually hit what he aimed at, but Jesus caused the man to move his head slightly. And when he did, the sword got his ear, and off went his ear. Now the Bible tells us that Jesus reached down and picked that man's ear up and placed it back on his head. Now that was Jesus for you. And he told Simon Peter, said, Put your sword up, Simon. This is no time to be fighting. And he made him put his sword up. But he was willing to fight for the Lord. And he'd have fought until he dropped dead there. Jesus allowed it, no doubt. And then again, he was falling afar off when he should have been treading in his master's footsteps. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 58, But Peter followed him afar off under the high priest's palace, and went in and sat with the servants to see the end. Now when they brought Jesus in to try him, Simon Peter followed afar off, just close enough to see where they were going and what they were doing. Now he should have been right there beside the Lord. He bragged about he would. He bragged about he'd suffer for him. He'd go to jail for him. He'd die for him. But now whenever they're carrying Jesus in to try him, where is Simon Peter? He's following afar off, not walking up there with Jesus like he should have been. Just like some of you sitting out there in the radio listening audience, you ought to be in God's house today, but you're falling afar off. Oh, you say, now preach it, but you know the weather's bad and it's raining. Yes. Are you going to stay off of your job tomorrow and next week if it's raining? That's always been a strange thing to me, and yet I know the answer. People say, well, it's just too bad and too rainy to go to God's house, but they'll get up the first thing in the morning or sometime next week if it's pouring down rain. They'll go to their job. Why? Well, you know why. They do whatever they want to do most and respond to what they love most. And people usually do what they want to do. If they love God, if they're walking right up close to God, they won't let a little rain keep them away from the house of God. They'll be there if they're walking in step with the Lord. Now, Simon Peter was falling afar off, and he wasn't walking up close to the Lord like he should have been, just like a lot of church members today sitting out there walking afar off from God when you ought to be up walking with the Lord. Then again, he was warming his hands at the fire of Christ's enemies, when he should have been warm in his heart at the sight of Christ's sorrows. In Luke chapter 22 and verse 55, and when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the hall and were sat down together, Peter sat down among them. Now he finally eased himself on the inside of the building. It was probably cold, and he had been walking afar off. He finally eased in, and he didn't want to get close to Jesus, of course, because he knew that he let him down. And he goes in, he sits down, and Christ is in great sorrow and great suffering. And Simon Peter is sitting at the fire there with Christ's enemies, warming his hands at the fire, just like that there's nothing happening. He was playing the hypocrite. He was sitting there as though he cared not what happened, or he wasn't a part of Christ's group. And he was sitting there at the fire, warming himself at the devil's fire, when he should have been warming his heart as he saw Jesus there being tried and of course headed for Calvary to be scourged and so forth, and there be crucified. That should have broken his heart. That should have warmed his heart, knowing what his dear Lord was about to endure. But nevertheless, big old Simon, high-tempered man, strong fisherman, cusser, standing there warming his hands at the devil's fire. Now, you don't need to be out here warming your hands at the devil's fire. You don't need to have any part in the evil and weakness of this world that's carried on, operated by Satan. You should walk close to God and warm your heart because you love him. And then again, he was denying when he should have been praying. Now, here's a man already bragged about the fact that he'd never deny the Lord. He would go to prison if need be. He would die for him if need be. And yet he's denying the Lord. In Luke chapter 22, verses 56 and 57, but a certain maid beheld him as he sat by the fire and earnestly looked on him and said, this man was also with him. And denied him, saying, woman, I know him not. Now here is Simon Peter sitting here with this crowd that's crucifying the Lord, and a little Jewish maiden came up and she looked at him and she recognized him. And she said, this man here, pointing out Simon, said, he's been with Jesus. I've seen him with the other apostles, and I've seen him around where Christ was ministering and performing miracles, and he's one of them. He's one of the 12. He's been with Jesus all along. That little girl, that little Jewish maiden, scared that big old fisherman half to death, and he denied that he knew the Lord, that he was a disciple, an apostle. He said, I'm not one of them. I'm not his disciple, or I'm not his apostle. He denied that he really served God and worked with the Lord. Sat there and denied that. And that little Jewish girl scared him half to death, as it were, and caused him to deny the Lord. He was afraid. And when he should have been praying, he was denying. I wonder, do you deny the Lord where you work, or out on where you associate with people or in your community? There's a man one time that got saved, and he said, when I go back to my group I work with, they'll make all kind of fun of me. They'll laugh at me. And the preacher and the others that want him to God said, dear man, you shouldn't worry about that. We'll be praying for you. God will give you grace. And so he went back to the old crowd. And then a few days later, he came back to associate with the Christian people that want him to God. And they immediately asked him, said, well, how did they treat you? What did they say? How did they act? He said, well, tell you the truth, they never did find it out. Now, that's the trouble with a lot of saved people today. They say they're saved, and they work on their jobs, and they never let people know they're saved. Kind of like Jimmy Carter, you know, whenever he went in as president, and he said he was a born-again Christian. And his brother that passed away here a few months ago said, well, he didn't know Jimmy was a born-again Christian till he read it in the paper. Now, beloved, we need to realize if we're saved, we need to let people know we're saved. They don't have to read it in the paper to find it out. And let them know we're saved, we're born again. And there's people you work with right now that don't know that you're supposed to be saved and you're born again Christian and that you're a member of the Northside Baptist Church. You haven't told them and they don't know it. Shame on you. You're denying the Lord. Shouldn't do that. Let them know immediately where you stand. Young man today is pastoring a church, saved under my ministry when he was just a little teenage boy. He was employed at one of the plants in Athens, and the first day he went to work, started carrying his Bible. And he just taking his Bible with him, and he didn't renege on the job and take up time reading his Bible. He loved that book. He carried it with him and lay it down there where he worked, and people didn't like it. Began to complain about it. You know, he finally lost his job because he's carrying his Bible to his work. They said, "We're not going to have that fanatic coming and bringing a Bible in here in this cloth room. We'll just get rid of him." He got rid of him. And I might spunk, I might be willing to do that, be identified with the Word of God. And he was ashamed of that book. You have church members today that are ashamed to bring the Bible to church. Shame on you. Always bring your Bible. I never go without my Bible. Ever since God saved me, I always carry my Bible to church. And you'll never see me. I don't care any time during the day or night. But what I will have that testament there of the Psalms and New Testament in my pocket. When I was in World War II, believe it or not, when I was in World War II, I got a hold of a leather case. We took it out of a P.O. box after conquering some territory where the Germans were. And it had a belt around, a leather case, and a flap on where you could buckle it down. And my Bible, same size as this one right here, fit into that case exactly, just fit just fine. I carried my Bible with me in basic training and overseas. And on the battlefront, I had my Bible. But that time I had it in my pack. But I took that Bible and tried it in that case to see how it fit. It fit exactly. I buckled that case around my waist and put my Bible in it. And during the entire time I was in combat, that Bible was on my hip like a cowboy carrying his pistol. Beloved, he was in that case. He's protected from the weather and the snow and the rain and ice. But that Bible was with me, the full Word of God, the complete old-fashioned King James Version Bible was on my hips the whole time I was fighting. There was a Jew boy, found out I was a Christian and knew God, and he, whenever we'd get ready to go into battle, he was right under my arms almost. He was right near me. He'd make it his business to get near me. Now, he was Jewish. He didn't supposed to believe in Christ. But you know what he said? He said, Edward's there, knows God, and he's a Christian and knows God. And I feel like if he knows God and God sees him through, if I stay close to him, he'll see me through. Well, he did. He made it through. He sure did. God saw me through and him too. And he believed that, although he was Jewish. And so you see, you never know what kind of influence you might have on people. Now we find here that Simon Peter was cursing when he ought to have been witnessing. Matthew 26 and 73 and 74, after a while came unto him, they that stood by and said to Peter, "Surely thou also art one of them, for thy speech betrayeth thee." Then began he to curse and to swear, saying, "I know not the man." See, he started cursing. Wasn't enough to deny his disciple, he just started cursing. Well, this old fisherman had a lot of curses in him. God had to shake him out of him. But he had them in him, and he started cursing. And that's about as cheap a ticket as a man ever went to hell on. But he was cursing and there denying the Lord and would not admit that he knew God. And since they wouldn't take his word for it, or his disciple, he thought if he started cursing out loud, they'd say, "Well, yeah, he's not one of them because Christians don't cuss." That's true today. Saved people don't curse. They don't take not God's name in vain unless they're backslid like Simon Peter. And so he began to curse. And they said, "Now, wait a minute here. We recognize your voice, fella. We have heard you talk and teach and follow Jesus around, and we know you by your voice. We've heard you before. Now, that's strange, isn't it? You know, I've been on the radio more than 40 years daily. I can today walk into a business place or store or where there's people gathered. I don't have to do anything but just speak a few words and people turn and look. I've heard that voice somewhere, they'd say. And many of them recognize it. They recognize my voice, been heard so many, many times. And they recognize I can not speak any place where there's people around Athens or where the radio covered my ministry, carried my ministry. I can just speak out and people turn and look. Now, the reason they look, they said, that voice is familiar. I've heard it someplace. And sometimes they recognize me. Sometimes they don't. They recognize the voice. They've heard it. And then it might dawn on them where they heard it. But anyway, they recognize Simon Peter by his voice. You know, when we get to heaven, I believe we're going to recognize each other's voices. You know why I believe that? When Jesus came after Christ's resurrection, he was in his glorified body. And he said, Mary. And she said, Master. She recognized that voice. He had the same voice he had before he was crucified. And before his body was glorified, he had that same voice. And I believe when we get to heaven, you're going to be recognized, certainly by your voice. Now, if your voice is not what it ought to be, God will tune it up for you. Mine will probably need to be tuning up when I get there because of what I'm preaching down here. But God will tune your voice up. It'll be beautiful and lovely, but people recognize that voice. I believe that. The Bible said we'd be like unto the Lord. And his voice is recognized. Now, so he cursed and they recognized him. Then while his heart was right, his methods were wrong. He got his heart right with God, but his methods were wrong. What he was doing was wrong. Now, there's a lot of saved people today, their heart's right, but their methods are not exactly right. And we need to line them up. And again, the look of the Lord broke his heart and unsealed the fountain of his tears. Luke chapter 22, verses 61 and 62. And the Lord turned and looked upon Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he said unto him, Before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Now, when Jesus caught the eyes of Simon Peter, and Simon Peter looked on the eyes of the Son of God, it tore him out of the frame. I mean, he started literally crying, shaking with sobs, and you could hear him a long way off as he wept because of what he had done. He had denied the Lord. He had cursed. Now Jesus there with a bleeding heart looks on him, and the old rooster crowed, and Simon Peter remembered. The Lord said, before the rooster crows twice, you're going to deny me three times. And he remembered that Jesus told him that, and he started weeping. One thing about a saved person, if they backslide on God, there's still a tender spot there. There's a spot can be touched that God can touch and bring them into sorrow and repentance. Saved people, not person not like that. You have to take the preached word of God and use a sword on them. But a word from the Lord, from the Bible, a word to bring back remembrance and how God loved you and died for you, many times will break your heart and bring you back into fellowship. And Simon Peter went out, and that big old fisherman, that man is full of curses, that man that had a sword is going to kill a man, that fellow began to weep, as humble as a little child. And then the bitterness of his tears revealed the real sweetness of his heart. Those tears rolling down his face, and he's shaking and weeping and wailing, and that showed he had a good heart, he had a tender heart. Tears reveal the kind of heart we have. You have a lot of people never shed a tear. They're too hard-hearted and stubborn. And you have others that have tender hearts, and they'll weep at most anything that'll touch them like that. Nothing wrong in that. That's a good sign. And then finally, he went out into the night of repentance and came back into the morning of restoration. He went out into the night of repentance and came back in the morning of restoration. That lets us know, although this man was full of blunders and made many mistakes, like you have, like I have. And others out in the radio listening audience have made mistakes that know God, they know they're saved, they made mistakes. That tells us that God, if we'll repent and be sorry for what we've done and the mistakes we've made and mean business, that God restores back into wonderful fellowship. When Jesus came back from the grave, he said, I must go and see Simon Peter. And he made a special trip to see Simon. Why? Jesus knew Simon Peter had a broken heart. And he knew Simon had was grieved and was weeping because of what he had done. And Jesus wanted to go help him. And Jesus went and talked to him personally. And he confessed up. And Jesus asked him, Simon, do you love me, Simon? He said, I know you love me. I know, Lord, you know I love you. Three times Jesus said, Simon, you love me more than these. Lord, you know I love you. And three times he said, I love you, Lord. After the resurrection, Jesus said, you go feed my lambs and you go feed my sheep. And when Jesus straightened him out and got those curses out of him, cooled that temper down and melted his heart, that old war horse of God got up on the day of Pentecost and pointed his finger at that gang of people out there crucified Jesus, and those Jews especially and the others. He said, you have killed the Son of God. You have crucified Jesus. You have his blood on you. You're guilty. You've crucified the Lord. He wasn't afraid of anything. He'd have walked into a circle of Saul. He'd have tackled a lion because God had restored him back, had the power of God on the inside of him, the word of God in his heart and mind. He looked those people in the face and told them they'd crucified God. And they began to weep, and they said, men and brethren, what shall we do? Simon Peter told them what to do, and 3,000 people got saved from that one sermon. A different Simon after he went through what he did. A lot of times, all you listening, I say this in closing, don't misunderstand me. A lot of times God's going to allow you to fall in the mud hole. You walk too close to the edge of it, God knows it. You play around that mud hole, God's going to allow you to fall in the mud hole. God's going to allow you to get involved or do something to really shock you and wake you up that you might come closer to him. He allowed it. Simon did that. I'm going to say this in closing. This may sound strange, but you'll have to know the meaning of it. There's a man one time, he wouldn't walk close to God. He was such a Pharisee and made it rough on his family. And this woman went to see the, no, this man went to see Preacher Caldwell and said to him, I need help. Caldwell knew this man. Caldwell was a wise old servant of God. And said, I need to do something. I said, what do you think I ought to do? And all that I might get straightened out. He said, it might help you if you got drunk and puked all over yourself. That's what he told him. Caldwell knew that man needed to bust the mud hole wide open or he'd never wake up. He didn't condone drinking and wasn't trying to encourage him to get drunk. He told him if he got drunk and puked on himself, it might help him. And there was a meaning, a message there for the man that was not literal. He didn't mean for him really to do it, but he's trying to get a point across to him. And that's what happened to Simon Peter.